Hello and welcome to the Practice Parlour. I am your host, Gina Morgano, and today I am here with Jonnet Solomon. Jonnet is an accountant by trade. However, she is also the owner and the lead preservationist of the National Opera House here in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Welcome, Jonnet.
Thank you. Thank you, Gina, for having me.
You're so welcome. I'm so excited to have you here. We have been trying to make this conversation work for months and months.
I know.
And the day is finally here. I am so excited for the world, or for at least my community, to get to hear all about the incredible work you are doing here in Pittsburgh. And the National Opera House is obviously, the word national is in it. It's a place of national significance. So I'm excited to hear your story and more about the Opera House. So if you could please share your background. I know that you have music in your family as well. So what was your background and how did you hear about the Opera House? What brought you to it? And what is the National Opera House?
Well, those are great questions to start. My background is I was born in Georgetown, Guyana in South America, and my dad is one of the original inventors of the steel pan. And that is actually what brought us to Pittsburgh. It was for him to work on his business and to grow the steel pan industry. And when we moved to Pittsburgh, of course, we did not know the city. We moved to the Hill District. And every week, my dad would take us driving around the city. And he said, you know, always get to know the city that you lived in. So driving around the city just became part of my life and part of my day. And to be honest, I get my best ideas when I'm driving around. And one day I'm driving around the city and I see a plaque in the house. I got out of my car, I read the plaque, and it said Home of the National Negro Opera Company. So I asked everyone I knew if they heard of this company. I'm like, have you heard of the National Negro Opera Company? And no one ever heard of it. So I went back to the house, gave myself a tour. It was empty. And it was an amazing, gorgeous house. So I told a friend of mine, I said, I think I'm going to buy the house that says National Negro Opera Company. And she said, Jonnet, if you buy it, I'll buy it with you. And I told my parents I found this house and I'm going to buy it and restore the history because no one knows about it. And my parents were like, Jonnet, before you buy a house, you need to get out of our house and move out, get your own house, and then think about buying some old abandoned mansion. However, I didn't listen. And we did purchase the house, and that's when this all started. During the time, I had just graduated from Duquesne University with an accounting degree. And every year at Duquesne and at my high school, you had to do a community service project. So I figured I'll just do my own community service project. And it'll take about 3 years, and then I'll just go back to working with, you know, Boys and Girls Club. But 22 years later, we're still working on getting funding and building support for the house, but it's been amazing.
Your story is so incredible in many ways. First of all, I lived in Pittsburgh. You know, I grew up in Pittsburgh. I'm back in Pittsburgh. I've lived in Pittsburgh for much of my life. And until the last year, I had no idea that this building existed. I had no idea that the opera company existed. And as a singer, I told you this before, I was actually sort of embarrassed and ashamed of myself. I was like, wait, what? How did I not know this existed in my own backyard?
It is not even your fault. You know, I spoke to a professor at Carnegie Mellon who teaches African-American music history. And he said, unless you take his class, you're not hearing about this amazing house. You're not hearing about Mary Cardwell Dawson, even if you go to CMU as an opera singer, if you don't take his class, you're not learning about it. So it's not your fault. It's, you know, we have to do more to celebrate our local history, do more to celebrate our local heroes and, you know, start local and then go national.
Yes. The other thing that I think is so incredible about your story is that you took on this massive project, at a very young age. And I think, you know, for myself, if I were to walk past a house, I see in the papers, you know, I'm like, oh, I would love to buy that house. And it's a dream. And I think that's impossible. Like, I don't have the money. I don't have the skills. I, you know, and you took that huge leap of faith.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, I mean, young and dumb, some amazing artist said that, you know, youth is wasted on the young, or young is wasted on the youth, something like that. And when you're young, you think you could do anything. You know, I think it was a great time for me to buy the house, because if someone came to me, even as an accountant, if someone came to me today, even if it was myself, and they're like, Jonnet, why don't you buy this massive Queen Anne style mansion that you'll never make any money on, and you're going to spend 50 years of your life educating, would you do it? I'm like, no, are you crazy? So I think you have to be young and naive to enter anything like this.
So for people who still don't know where the house is, mm-hmm. it is at 7101 Apple Street in the Homewood neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And could you please tell us about the house's history?
Yes, so it is at 7101 Apple Street. And the house originally was owned by the Schaefer family. And the Schaefer family then sold the house. And when it was purchased by Woogie Harris is when it really became famous and was a legacy. Woogie Harris was named the bank in the Black community. His brother was Teenie Harris. And the house served as a gathering place, a safe place. It was a hotel. Roberta Clemente lived in the house. Lena Horne stayed in the house. Joe Louis, Count Basie, they all stayed at the house. In addition to that, Woogie Harris rented the house to Mary Cardwell Dawson. And she started the National Negro Opera Company on the third floor. And she started giving piano lessons and music lessons to people like Bobby McFerrin and Ahmad Jamal. And that's really what made the house famous. But we have pictures of the house with Lena Horne and Joe Louis sitting in the living room, and Roberta Clemente, you know, with famous Steelers, you know, just hanging out in the tea room. And I always wished, I'm like, oh my gosh, I would love to go to a party with a jazz singer sitting on my left and a professional, you know, football player on my right, and a professional baseball player with like an opera singer in the middle. Like that's just the ultimate evening to me.
I have chills. I'm literally tearing up because that also sounds like the ultimate evening to me as well. It's just so cool. And, you know, it's fitting for Pittsburgh because Pittsburgh does have such a rich mm-hmm. arts history as well as sports history, and those cultures coming together. That is just so neat.
Yeah. So it's amazing.
Yeah. So there is the physical house, mm-hmm. and then there is the opera company. Yes. And could you speak a little bit more about the opera company and Mary Cardwell Dawson and all the work that she did?
Oh my gosh. Yes. So when I met Mary Cardwell Dawson, she became a hero. So I didn't meet her in person, of course, because this is way after. But when I met her as a legendary heroic figure, it really changed my life, because she was a classically trained artist, opera singer, and she auditioned to sing with the Pittsburgh Opera, who basically told her she'll never have a chance to be on the stage. And that gave her the passion and the fire to start the National Negro Opera Company. And the goal for the company originally was to provide access to a main stage for people who just didn't have access. And it was for people who basically were denied the ability to share their talent with the world. And Mary Cardwell Dawson wanted to give people that chance, that opportunity to just share their talent with audiences. And when she started, it was a music school. And the music school taught piano and voice lessons, but she also gave costume designers a chance, and makeup artists, and hairdressers, and people who would never do makeup for a show. She was like, you're doing makeup for a show. So it went way beyond the stage. You know, she made sure that the audience had perfect lighting because she gave a chance to lighting people who didn't have it. And her goal was basically to just have people who have talent have access. And what that told me is, as an audience member, we would love to sit in the audience where you have the absolute most talented people doing a production. So you have the best lighting, the best costume, the best hair, the best dance, the best voice, so that you as the audience get the most, you know, unique experience. And that's what the company did. But she pushed everyone that worked for her. I have a program where on day one, they did one opera. The second day, they did another opera. And the third day, they did a whole different opera, three different operas all in a row at the Syria Mosque, completely sold out.
Wow, that's incredible.
I know.
So the opera company, though, traveled, right? It wasn't just in the house.
Oh my gosh, yes. Mm-hmm. So the house has an amphitheater, which we're going to restore. And I'm so excited about this because outdoor shows are amazing. And so they performed Aida outside at the house. But before it was an outdoor amphitheater, it was the first golf course in the city of Pittsburgh. So it has history for different reasons. The first golf course in the city of Pittsburgh was at the Opera House. And then they turned that into a stage, an amphitheater. So how amazing is that? And so they performed Aida here at the house, and then they performed at the Syria Mosque, and then they traveled all over the country performing.
Wow.
They that even performed at the Met, which people don't realize the first Black company to perform at the Met was the National Negro Opera Company. Because Mary Cardwell Dawson asked if they can perform there, and they said, sure, you can, but not on the main stage in the center. And you can't use the moniker, and you can't use our lighting. And Mary Cardwell Dawson said, okay, that's fine. And the night of the show, they set up in the middle of the stage, and they put their name in the moniker, and they used the lighting.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
That's
incredible. And just the more I hear you talk, the more I just feel like people need to know about this. And I can't believe that this was not a part of my own music history learning. And as a Pittsburgher, that it has not been a part of the main Pittsburgh history lessons that we all learn. Mm-hmm. And I'm so excited for what you're doing and for the potential to bring this back to the national conversation and the local conversation. And I would love to hear more about your dreams and your vision for preserving and restoring this incredible venue.
Of course. You know, when I first read about Mary Cardwell Dawson and what she was trying to do, I said, why was this not possible? She wanted to take talented people, that's easy, and put them on a stage. That seems easy enough, with a group of other talented people. Sounds doable. And when you read about the opposition that she got in terms of the union and people not wanting Black people on stage, or saying a certain part is only for a certain person, or only certain people can sing certain songs, you started seeing all the barriers, not only in opera, but in performance and theater. You start seeing the classism and all the isms, you know, become barriers to just talent being on stage to engage an audience. And our vision at the Opera House is to, of course, restore the house, because that is important, but also to restore and finish Mary Cardwell Dawson's dream of just having the equity for anyone with talent to be able to showcase their talent to an audience. And I think every single person, every audience member really deserves to even see that opportunity happen.
Absolutely. So tell me where things stand now. What are you in the process of doing? What help are you looking for? Where are you on this journey?
So that's a great question because, as I mentioned, when we bought the house, it was a 3-year plan. I'm like, in 3 years, I will raise the money, we'll restore the house, we'll do, you know, performances in the amphitheater, the whole community will come out, people will wave at each other, and it's going to be awesome. And when we started, no one knew about the house. So it was, why would we give you funding for something we don't know exists? Or the foundations would say, Jonnet, where is this? This sounds amazing. I'm like, oh, it's right here in Pittsburgh. It's in your backyard. So we hired a historian, and we spent 13 years collecting just data and artifacts to say, this is why this is legitimate and important. So it took 13 years to listen to the stories and just gather everything that was needed. After that, we started the fundraising, just writing grants, writing letters. And until 2020, we were denied. Every application was a no. But in 2020, we applied for the 11 most endangered structures in America. And we made it to the list as the one of the 11 most endangered places and the number one place to preserve. And Forbes magazine ran the article, and then people started reaching out to me to say, Jonnet, where is this? These are my friends too. These weren't strangers. These are people in my phone. Like, Jonnet, you're doing this? Where is this? I'm like, I've been talking about this for 20 years. And that is when the resurgence started and people started saying, okay, how can I help? We received a major grant from RK Mellon, and that really was the catalyst of for other people to start giving funds and helping us. But, you know, it's a $3 to $4 million project. You know, as prices go up, we're looking at a $4 million project. And we're about halfway there in the fundraising. And so we're just, number one, looking for advocates. I think the money will come, but we need people to really uplift and advocate for the program and for equity, just like you're doing here today. You know, these shows, these podcasts, it gets the word out.
In the grand scheme of fundraising, it's not that much money, right? I mean, $4 million.
I know.
Right? I mean, I don't have $4 million. I wish I did. I would give it to you, but you're welcome. But, you know, thinking about huge fundraising projects and, you know, other institutions that have raised a lot of money. And in some ways, I think it does come down to awareness and the profile of it. You know, I was thinking, and prior to this conversation, I was thinking of Beyonce, and I was like, man, if she only knew about this, like, I mean, really, like, seriously,
I feel like Jonnet, you should call Tyler Perry and let him know about the project. I was like, oh my gosh, Tyler Perry's not in this phone, but let me get my other phone with Tyler Perry's number. But I agree with you. It's not a lot of money, honestly. I mean, I don't have it either. But in terms of fundraising, it's not like earth-shattering amount of money. It is something doable, but it just takes building awareness first. People will think it's important when we educate them on why it's important. I mean, you went to school, you know, classically trained, and no one talked about the Opera House or Mary Cardwell Dawson. Imagine if every student that studied opera, just opera, learn about Mary Cardwell Dawson. It would make my job easier because people would be like, of course we need to preserve her legacy. But we're starting from ground zero, and that's always a lot harder.
Yeah. I have so many questions and thoughts. The direction I'm going to go next is, you mentioned the word perseverance and how you were rejected from grants for decades. And yet you persevered, and, you know, I like P words, so preservation, perseverance. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, you're such an inspiration in that way. And I think for everybody, whatever matters to them and whatever service project is on their heart, you haven't given up. And that's so incredibly inspiring.
Thank you. I mean, it's important to know because I know for me, I remember once I called everyone in my phone and asked them to just give a donation, anything, even a dollar, because the house was facing condemnation. And I didn't know what it meant, but I knew I needed money. And after I called everyone, I think I raised less than $100. And I took my phone and I just threw it out. Like, I just dumped it. And I was so frustrated. And I said, how can this be this hard? But what helped me to keep going and persevered is Mary Cardwell Dawson, not once did she complain. She never stopped. And she was there just as a mentor and an inspiration for every single person that she was giving an opportunity. And I thought, in the 1940s, life was a lot more difficult than it is for me in 2000. And so there's no reason that with, you know, better life, better community, more access, I can't keep going when she kept going in the 1940s. So really, Mary Cardwell Dawson is the inspiration, and women like her who persevere through so many things to see success happen and just to see the world evolve and also for yourself to evolve. For me to even get to this point, I had to go through an evolution, and perseverance is what pushed me to do that.
Wow, that's amazing. So you mentioned the grant from the Mellon Foundation. Yeah. I know when we were speaking before, there are some major cultural institutions that are on board. Are you at liberty to speak about that at all?
Absolutely. Yeah. So RK Mellon, of course, started this, and I'm forever grateful to their belief in myself and the project. Without someone believing in you, it is hard to persevere. I mentioned earlier that I bought the house with a friend, and until she passed away, she really believed that we can do this. And she probably still does from another place. But RK Mellon giving us that grant was mental in where we are. And then we received the AW Mellon, which is a national grant, very, very difficult to get. And all of our advocates at AW Mellon, believing in myself and the project, really pushed to make this happen. And locally here in Pittsburgh, we were given a grant from the Allegheny Foundation and the Burke Foundation. So we do have amazing names behind the project, and we hope to continue to get funding and support.
You also mentioned about the gathering the artifacts and things like that. Mm-hmm. Who all is involved with the history, with preserving the physical history beyond the house itself?
Yeah, so I mean, so many people, you know, until we received funding in 2020, so from 2000 to 2020, 20 years, every single person who worked on this project was a volunteer. And I could not even think the amount of people that volunteered to gather information. So many groups, so many people that helped. So, I mean, you think on one hand, not much has been done, but so much has been done, but there's so much to be done. And so we have gathered costumes, which is at the Heinz History Center, music, like original music and composition, just playbills. So there, we have over 30,000 articles of items that have been gathered that reside at the Library of Congress, Heinz History Center, Carnegie Museum of Art. So these things that were in people's basements, their attics, you know, it was just, you know, sitting around until everyone came together to collect it.
That is an astonishing number of artifacts.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
So you mentioned that equity and accessibility and opportunity for people to perform their art and lend their talents was very important to Mary Cardwell Dawson. What is your plan for programming, educational programming? What do you envision for the Opera House once it's restored?
So we envision having professional development, education, lessons, pretty much what Mary Cardwell Dawson was doing. We envisioned just finishing that bridge, and we envisioned partnership. I think partnership is so important to building equity, because you may not know someone that can get you somewhere, but we may know them. And so partnership, community, and building relationship is what we're going to add to professional development to help artists and art organizations come together to give opportunities to people who just don't have it.
I love that. It's so important.
It is.
So you also mentioned about getting involved in your community and knowing your local history.
Yes.
Could you speak more about that role in your life?
Absolutely. You know, as I mentioned, we're from Guyana, and Guyana is a small country. We're from Georgetown, but in Georgetown, in Guyana, everyone speaks to each other. They say good morning, good afternoon. They sit and they have a chat. They get to know who you are. And that is what builds community. It's also what keeps people safe. You know, it's like, I see you, I say hi to you, we meet eyeball to eyeball, so you're not robbing me tomorrow, you know? And so in the community where the Opera House is, it was very close knit, and everyone helped each other. And it's really what helped the success of many, many artists. And we want to bring that back. We want people, you know, doing service projects together, working together, and really building relationships. Because I think when you have really strong relationships, it just makes the world better. You know, if you see me at a cafe, you're like, Jonnet, hey, how are you? How's it going? Opposed to, I don't know you. Don't speak to me. I don't know what you're doing. So, you know, building that relationship and just starting one by one and then building community is why we want to be known as the National Opera House, because we want to take the word community from just your street or your street corner to just everyone who has the same belief and philosophy and principles that you have.
That's beautiful. I love that. So talk to me more about service, because I know obviously you are so passionate about service. And yes, you mentioned having annual service projects. Mm-hmm. And then you took on this lifetime service project.
Yes. I didn't even know it would be a lifetime, but I did say a few years ago, okay, this is my service project until death. So my introduction to service started in high school. I went to high school here in the South Hills at Keystone Oaks. And to graduate from Keystone Oaks, you needed, I think it was 150 hours of community service. So I said, okay, I'll do this. And it was myself and a friend who's now famous, actually. His name is Zach Quinto. So Zach and I went and we volunteered at the Boys and Girls Club. And we had a great time. I think there's even a TV clip of us, you know, Zach did an interview and I was like in the back helping the students. And we both were like, oh my gosh, this was amazing. We're going to continue. So Zach and I continued to do so much service projects together. And then I continued to volunteer with Boys and Girls Club, United Way, Salvation Army. You know, we were building playgrounds. And I had a great mentor at the time. Her name was Erica. And she was like, Jonnet, come back and volunteer. And then when I went to college, part of Duquesne at the time was community service. And so I continued. And what that did was build relationships, got me into communities that I would absolutely never have been introduced to had I not been volunteering. And it gave me experiences. And I think really the experiences is why I got hooked, because I'm like, you would never get this experience if you weren't doing this thing. And that's why I continue to just do community service.
Yeah. Do you have any tips or practices for people looking to get more involved with service, but maybe don't know what service project to take on or worried about getting in over their heads?
Well, I think start with something that you want to change. You know, it's always, for me, I like fairness. For some reason, I like things to be fair. I don't care if I lose as long as it was a fair game, you know? And so I always looked at places that there was not enough fairness and said, what can I do to help to change this? And that turned into community service. So I would say start with something that you just don't like. Like you see it and you're like, I just don't like this. And then sign yourself up to start doing something about it, either with an organization or just do it. You know, here on the north side, there's a lady that picks up litter. She just doesn't like seeing litter. She gets out every day. I see her picking up the litter. That's where I would say start, because you would be passionate about just changing something that you just don't like. Like, it needs to be different in the world.
Mm-hmm. That's great. I also remember when we spoke before, I might be misquoting you, but I remember you saying something like service is a place, or service begins mm-hmm. in a place. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Could you speak more to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I do agree with that, that service isn't even a specific space. It's a place you actually have to find within yourself. And that is what builds community. Sometimes it's easy to sit, complain, you know, like I was saying just now, just talk about what you don't like. But when you can find a place within yourself to really do something about it, that's when it changes the world. I'm not saying it's easy. I know for me, you know, I said something needs to be done about the history, because I took history in class. I did okay. I didn't fail. Took history in college. Did okay, but I never learned about the Opera House or Mary Cardwell Dawson. And so that wasn't fair to me. You know, I'm like, something needs to be done about our history being taught here in Pittsburgh. So something just needs to change with the education. So finding that place and that space within yourself is really the first step. But it's hard, because it means, you know, like me, I had to say goodbye to old Jonnet. Like, old Jonnet has left the building, and hello to new Jonnet, because old Jonnet can't go where new Jonnet needs to go to make change happen. And, you know, finding that space within yourself really is the evolutionary process that helps us become who really we were meant to be, but we fight against it.
Yes, yes, yes. I think that's true for everything, not only service, but any changes that we want to make. You have to let go of the old, make space for the new.
Yes. It's so hard, because you're like, you know, you like where you are for the most part, and you know it, and it's comfortable. But for you to evolve, to be greater, you have to leave that old self behind. And it's difficult. Because, you know, I am a musician. I play the steel pan, and I have been in a family band for a long time. And I'm an accountant. You know, I went to school. I'm trained. I understand debits and credit. But I'm not a preservationist. I'm not a historian. I'm not an archivist. Like, all of these names people are putting to me, I'm like, that's that new person that I have not evolved to yet, but I will get there. And you have to just push yourself to really get to that, you know, that new self.
Yes. And I'm thinking too, what people have often said about musicians and writers, where if you play music, you're a musician. If you write, you're a writer. And yet, I think sometimes those labels can be scary. And so sometimes we don't, like, we won't play our music, or we won't write.
Right.
And we'll hold ourselves back. But yeah,
it's comfortable.
Right. Yeah. I so mm-hmm. admire your willingness to learn as you go and to take on something new and something huge.
Yeah. I think as I'm going through this process, and I'm not finished yet at all, I'm learning that the key in life is to say yes to those experiences, because you know, it's easy to get stuck, or it's easy to get in your head to say, I know what I know and I'm good. But it's better when you can go through experiences that doing something of service can only bring to you, because service means no one's paying you. No one's calling you to be up at 7 a.m. Like, there's no pressure. It's all on you to give, and not just give, but with gratitude, because you actually signed yourself up for the assignment. So you can't even blame anyone for it. And service just creates that space in your being, like, Janae, no one told you to buy this house. You know, no one told you to sign up for this. And so it's all on you now to be accountable and responsible for your own decision.
How does a typical day work for you? Because I'm very curious how you manage this massive project along with your job as an accountant. Like, how do you actually get it all done?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, I will say my sister did buy me a no button a few years ago, and that was helpful. I like two no buttons. But the key for me is I'm highly organized, and I'm not saying that's a good or bad thing. I'm just highly organized. It could be a condition for some people. And I'm not a time waster, you know, so I'm the person that if we're in a meeting, you have an agenda, go through the agenda, and it's like, great, you know. And I think someone was asking me this earlier, because I have a 13-year-old daughter, and they're like, how do you find time to do all these things? And it's priority, you know, like, you really have to prioritize what you care about and then go in order. And in addition to having that priority list, you have to be disciplined. You really just have to discipline yourself to say, I've said yes to this. I'm going to commit and see it all the way through. So that means I'm saying no to everything else. So when someone says, Janae, can you sit on my board? No, I can't. I have my own board. Like, you know, so it's like, I can't sit on your board. So there's so many things that you have to discipline yourself and then not feel bad about it, because these are your priorities. So that's how I'm able to do it. Just being highly organized, having priorities, and then not feeling bad about the priorities you set for yourself, because that will eat you up.
Yeah, that's really, really great insight and advice. So I just want to speak a little bit more about the Opera House and its history and Pittsburgh history and in schools, like what is taught, because I think there's so much opportunity, as you mentioned. What are you seeing? What would you like to see? What are your plans for making this history more well-known with the youth, with musicians? Like, where would you like to see it taught, and what are your tactical plans for it?
That's a really good question. I would love for every city to just have a local history class from kindergarten to high school. I think if we just started there, you know, if I met you and you're from Boston, I don't know anything from Boston, I'm from Pittsburgh, and you're like, did you know in Boston? And you're telling me all these things, and then I'm telling you about Pittsburgh. That's a great conversation to me. But if I'm only learning about the war over here and this in history class, you know, and all these things you learn in history that I can't even remember right now on the spot, but it certainly was not Mary Cardwell Dawson, that doesn't seem relevant. You know, I know recently I was at Westinghouse High School and I told the students I'm restoring the house. And they're like, oh my gosh, I passed that house on the way to school. They immediately connected with the house and the history because they knew it. It was in their backyard. Even people here in Pittsburgh, when I tell them about the project and what I'm doing, they're like, that sounds fascinating. Where is it? And I'm like, it's here in Pittsburgh. They're like, what? How? So, You know, I don't know if I have the capacity to take on the educational curriculum within schools, but what I would love to see is local history become part of school curriculum, even if it's just a guest speaker speaking about local history, and not just the Opera House. There's a lot of local history that people don't even know here in Pittsburgh. And what I would love to see is on the college level, people who are studying music to be introduced to people like Mary Cardwell Dawson, because I think her story is inspiring. As a musician, you know, when this is the practice parlor, right? And I've practiced a lot of hours, like an insane amount of hours, but not enough. And I know there's times where I'm practicing something and I just can't get it. But if you're introduced to people like Mary Cardwell Dawson and you see how she persevered and got through and was successful, it puts you in a different space. And you're like, you know what? I'll take a break. I'll come back. I'll practice again and then keep on going. Because you have this vision of someone that you have learned about that they've already done what you're doing and they were successful at it. So I just think that is just really important to be introduced to those real life people in history, just as an inspiration for yourself.
Yes, yes, absolutely. It is amazing when you think about it. This was the 40s, was the main period of the house's you know, heyday. And if you just think of everything that was going on in the world and in the country, and in Pittsburgh, if you just think about Pittsburgh's history, as you mentioned, and, you know, the athletes and the artists that have come from the city, and the fact that so many people gather together at this house, it's such a beautiful thing. And just the opportunity that our common collective history has to bring us together now, that if we understand what happened back then, we can come together now.
But it's not happening. Like, that is what I don't get. It's actually not happening. You know, I don't know the last time you went to a party, even before COVID, and you're sitting there and you're like, there's so-and-so football player. There's so-and-so baseball player. There's so-and-so jazz musician. There's that opera singer. Like, when do we have this type of space? That's what I would love to bring, where anyone can go in the Opera House at any given day and see like a whole host of people that are inspirational and just have a very unique experience that only existed in that moment.
Yes. I have chills again because when I created this podcast, The Practice Parlour, it was actually a dear friend of mine came up with the name because I love everything Victorian. Mm-hmm. And the idea of the podcast, it started during the pandemic. So it was of starting conversations and bringing people together. And it harkens back to that image of these parlors and these salons where all these people would just come and play music and have conversations. Mm-hmm. And I just, I also would love to bring that back. And
well, the Opera House had a tea room, which we are putting the tea room back in there. And we have the original tea room menu, and that's going to be part of the opening for the tea room. And what I love about the tea room is you would have people like Woogie Harris, who was a numbers runner. He was the first African-American billionaire racketeer. And then you would have like the Rooneys in the tea room. And then you would have Count Basie. Like these, they're just sitting around in the tea room having conversations at a Queen Anne style mansion. Like, that blows my mind, honestly.
That is so cool.
Yes.
So how can people get involved? How can people help you? And obviously, I know you're looking for fundraising, but also, you know, people who are unable to give financially, how can they get involved as well?
So what we need artist advocates. You know, we need, like, what you're doing is so amazing, and I cannot thank you enough for having me on the show today, because it gives me the opportunity to tell the story. And that's what we need. We need people with an interest just like yourself who want to hear the story and tell the story, but really just share the history. I think with enough advocates, I always say we need an army of advocates. Because if this army is out there saying, did you hear about the Opera House? Do you know about the Opera House? No, I don't know about the Opera House. Then it gets the word out. And maybe it will get to, you know, a Beyonce or a Tyler Perry or an Oprah, where they're like, what is this Opera House? We need to help. So beyond money, we need people to advocate for the project and restoration, preservation, education, and even advocating for local history to be taught, even if it's in high school or college, because we can't do everything as an organization. Our goal is to restore the house and to build access and equity. What we need are just advocates who build this community to come together to say, we believe in this too. So let's come together and build it in the world. That's why, you know, nationally, that's the goal.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, I'm so excited about this because of not only its historical significance, but the potential it has for the future.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, so many different angles and ways, from the education to the tea room to the performances to the local history. Like, there's just so many aspects of it that can make a huge, huge impact in the local and national conversation in terms of the arts, in terms of history, in terms of preservation, just so many things.
Yes, it's true. I mean, there's so much happening. It's amazing it happened in this one amazing space. But it also is sad that people are not talking about it. And that's why I say the number one thing your audience can do is just advocate for the project. And also, I think advocating for the project will make it easier for the next person to have a shorter journey. I don't want to see someone coming along to preserve a space and it takes 25 years. Like that, I mean, I'll give the 25 years because I'm already 22 years in, but like, I don't wanna see, you know, your family member who may now be 10, you know, when they're 20, spending 25 years to preserve anything in Pittsburgh. It just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, so for anyone who is listening or watching, my request for you is to tell someone about this.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So we have two parlor games that I ask all guests. The first is called Lighting the Candle. What is a person, resource, organization, idea that you would like to pass the torch to and illuminate?
That's a great one. I'd pass it to Lee Pugliano. And she is doing the Equity Impact Center. And because without equity, you can't have fairness. And as I mentioned before, fairness is like that's my thread. It's like, can we be fair? So I'd like to light the candle to the Equity Impact Center.
Thank you. And our last game is called The Parrot. If we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
I think I would teach everyone to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jonnet, for being here. Thank you for visiting the Practice Parlor and sharing your story and the incredible story of the National Opera House and Negro Opera Company. I am just so thrilled that we were finally able to connect and have this conversation, and that more people will now get to hear about this rich history and all of the beautiful work that you are doing.
Thank you.
You're welcome. How can people get in touch with you, get involved with the Opera House Preservation Project?
The best way is our website, which is nationaloperahouse.org.
Great. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here. I am so excited for us to continue our conversation and to see where this goes. There's just so much wonderful that I know is going to be in your future and in Pittsburgh's future and in the cultural landscape, thanks to your work. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.